standing in for Dr. Ron Weisberger, who wishes desperately to be here. Dr. Weisberger is under the weather and can't make it. But he is, as many of you know, the director of the Holocaust Center here at Berkeley. I know graciously do at this point in proceedings, and we thank a whole bunch of people, including the Jewish Federation of New Bedford, Christian Community College, staff, faculty, administration, general support, Linnell Dean. He's been instrumental in all kinds of ways in support of Wow, I just had two hours of conversation with Larry Langer. That's pretty cool. I learned a lot, Mr. Langer, and I continue to learn from him. I teach the Holocaust course with Dr. Weisberger. We've taught this course for about 14 years. It continues to be a learning experience for all of us. I have, as many of our students know, one of our critical texts in the class is Art from the Ashes, a remarkable anthology of Holocaust literature that crosses genres. We had a long conversation about the publication history of that remarkable anthology. It's a treasured text. I hope if you don't have it, that you can go ahead and purchase one. It's quite available. Let me say something about Professor Langer, if I can. It's no exaggeration to say that Professor Lawrence Langer invented the field of Holocaust literature. It simply did not exist as we understand it right now before he began to do his research. He is a scholar of Holocaust literature. He's a professor of English Emeritus at Simmons College in Boston. He is considered the foremost scholar of the Holocaust in the field of literature and, very importantly, testimony. Among his works, The Holocaust and the Literary Imagination, his first work on the Holocaust, which is groundbreaking, as I noted. That was followed by The Age of Atrocity, Death in Modern Literature, Versions of Survival, The Holocaust and the Human Spirit, Holocaust Testimonies, especially valuable work for us in this class, The Ruins of Memory, Admitting the Holocaust, Collective Essays, and Preempting the Holocaust. And as I say, he's also the editor of Art from the Ashes, the Holocaust Anthology. We often draw upon the headnotes, introductions to the Art from the Ashes, and especially we adopt and use a term that Dr. Langer coined, which is choiceless choices. These were the unprecedented situations, conflicts that faced many Jews during a terrible time known as the Holocaust. It sadly is all too applicable to many of the choices that people had to make under terrible duress. I should say about Holocaust testimonies, it was based on a study of survivors' oral testimonies in the Yale archive, and won a National Book Critics Circle Award, and was named one of the top 10 books of 1991 by the New York Times Book Review. It was one of the first scholarly works to examine survivors' testimonies as a basis for understanding the Holocaust. We talked about this in my office a while ago. I think one of the things that I most admire about the anthology is the insistent tone that Dr. Langer adopts of both reference for the experience that these survivors went through, but also a kind of insistence not to accept easy solutions, easy answers, easy parallels, not to try to find a silver lining in a moment in history that was, of course, known by its atrocity. That is, in some ways, his vision is unaltered, and it's only the zeal of accomplices. He continues to look into the abyss, never looks away. For that, I truly admire him. I was just saying, lastly, that his study of testimony has been instrumental in my understanding of memory studies, essentially. That is, his terms that he's used in Ruins of Testimony to recognize different strands, levels, categories of memory, of deep memory, of anguished memory, humiliated memory, tainted memory, unheroic memory. In other words, he still gave us all the vocabulary with which to talk about the use of memory when it comes to survivor testimonies, the testimony of survivors of trauma, especially. Okay, I think I've said enough, and without further ado, Professor Langer, please join us.
Thank you so much. I hope we get to hear the second half of this report. Thank you for coming out of this horrendous weather. there's only one happy thing about it. I didn't miss the Red Sox game. I first began watching Survivor Testimony in 1984. At the time, Survivor Testimony was not highly regarded by Holocaust historians. Almost all of them felt that survivor memory was unreliable memory, as if the experiences they went through faded in time, and the stories they told could not be trusted. Nothing I discovered could be further from the truth. And today, let me talk about this, but today, most historians now use survivor testimony in their works because for many aspects of the Holocaust, the only evidence we have is the testimony of the survivor. Because in many camps, the Germans kept no records whatsoever, and if we didn't have the survivors to talk about it, we'll know nothing about it. When I first began looking at testimonies, and by now I'd watched, between 150 and 200 testimonies, I suppose. I've done 84 interviews of my own with Holocaust survivors. And when I began, as so often happens with research, I began with some premises which I hoped to validate as I went along. Those of you planning to go into research, I would suggest that may be the wrong way to go about it. Because what you're tempted to do is to find evidence to support your premises that may not be there so that you can support your premises. When I began, I was determined to find what has been called, not by me, the survivor syndrome, as if there was a special faculty, way of being, that could be shared by all survivors. I watched the first four or five testimonies, and I discovered that was a mistake. What I discovered was every survivor had his or her own story to tell in his or her own way, and with very few exceptions, they didn't share the same experience, even if they were in the same camp. I would watch three testimonies from three survivors of Auschwitz, and hear three different stories, not three contradictory stories, but three different stories. So I very quickly discarded the notion for the survivor syndrome. I found later that that expression was invented by a psychologist who was interviewing survivors shortly after the war and felt the need to find a category. And that's a mistake. What I like to say is there's no such thing as they. The Germans used to talk about the Jews as they, as if they were all the same. Of course, they weren't. There's no such thing as the survivor. And what I learned, well, I learned a number of things very quickly. First thing I learned was that my task was made easy as an interviewer because all I had to do was create a supportive atmosphere within which the survivor could tell his or her story. And now and then I would intervene to say, could you expand on that a little, could you explain that? What I discovered was the survivors knew their stories. A notion has been developed, again by psychologists, please, if there are psychologists in the audience, this is not a campaign to criticize your profession, but some of it in regard to the Holocaust deserves a lot of criticism, I must confess. They knew what they were saying. I never discovered a single example of what has been called repressed memory, in which it was clear to me the survivor was hiding things. There were things survivors refused to talk about, but that was because they chose not to. Of course, they were so terrible, they didn't want other people to know about it. They, since these tapes would be available to family members, they may not have wanted family members to know about it. And so they said, I'd rather not talk about that. And I said, fine, we don't have to talk about that. But that was fair. I can tell you stories that survivors told me, but it's so hand-raising that I don't talk about them. What I'm going to show you, if I can show them to you, are... Oh, you got it? There's always a magician around if you need. What I discovered was that I just had to trust my survivors, and they would tell me the story. One of my other premises was that, although it might not begin as a happy occasion, it was going to end as a happy occasion because the person I'm talking to is still alive and had survived the experience. That was shot down rather quickly by an interviewer who said to the survivor, who happened to be, he was 14 when the war ended, happens to be a rabbi today. I think he's still alive, very comfortably. And the interviewer said, I bet you were very happy when you were liberated. And he said, well, I sat down on the stone and then he begins to sob. He said, to tell you the truth, there was no one else but me. They had killed everyone else. Here I was, a 14-year-old boy. I had no family. I had no place to go back to. What was I going to do? I was all alone. So, another thing I learned very quickly was to avoid, and some people do this today, to avoid turning the Holocaust experience into a triumphalist narrative. For years, survivor memoirs were published, and if you read the blurb on the back, some well-intentioned member of the publishing company had written, this book celebrates the triumph of the human spirit. And then I would read the book, and it would be like the rabbi's story. Some would say I lost 8 members of my family. I interviewed one man who came in with, you know, these rolls of paper tape you used to have which you could, to write memos on. And he unfurled it. He said, I wrote down last night the 36 members of my family whom they killed. So he's still alive. There's no way you can change this into a triumphalist narrative. So another thing I had to think about was to ignore the people who had difficulty listening to these stories and try to make them better than they were. There's no happy Holocaust story. I'll give you an example. Even if someone survived, well, this is the third thing I discovered. I thought I was going to listen to a chronological story. I was born, grew up, I went to school, the Germans came, we were deported. I went to various camps where I worked in factories, and when the war ended, I was still a survivor. That's a chronological story, and that existed. That was there. But the more I looked at these, the more I thought about it, I said to myself, that is the surface story. What I'm also hearing is a subterranean story. That's not a story of living, it's a story of dying. Not of me dying because I'm still alive, but a story of their dying. You'll see examples of that when I start showing these things. And I was looking for a term. Howard mentioned the quest for a vocabulary appropriate to the Holocaust. It's always been a real challenge for me. I interviewed one woman whose parents were killed, and in her interview she says, when my parents died, and she says, no, no, my parents died. She says, when they killed my parents, she says, no, no. She says, you know, I don't have a word for what they did to my parents. And when I heard that, I said, well, we've got to find words. That's what inspired me, and I'll talk about it later, to invent the expression, choiceless choice, which is now part of Holocaust discourse. One of my proudest achievements. You Google choiceless choice and see what comes up. And so I discovered there was a counter-narrative in which the survivor would say, of course I'm alive, but I'm also dead. And I said, that's impossible. being here alive. But, you know, when someone says something like that, you can't laugh and discount it. You have to ask yourself, what can that possibly mean? There's a survivor of Auschwitz named Charlotte Delbo who wrote a remarkable trilogy called Auschwitz and After. If you read no book about the Holocaust, you should read that. And after the war, she survived Auschwitz. She visits a friend of hers in the hospital in Paris, just giving birth to a baby. The friend was also in Auschwitz. She goes to visit him in the hospital, and her friend is crying. She says, what are you crying for? She says, you just gave birth to a beautiful baby boy. And she says, I can't stop thinking about all those children in Auschwitz who never came back. And then she said in French, and please correct me if I'm saying this wrong, je me meurs en Auschwitz, mais personne ne le voit. She says, I died in Auschwitz, but no one sees it. And I said to myself, what can she possibly mean by that? Because she's alive. I said, but that must mean something. Then I read a memoir by a woman named Hannah Levy. I can't remember her last name. Called Diary of Bergen-Belsen. She was a journalist. She was in Bergen-Belsen. And as the end of the war approached, she realized that she and some of the other women are going to survive. And when British troops arrived, she writes in her diary, we have survived. Nash. But we are dead. And I said to myself, again, what could that possibly mean? So I invented a word for it called death-like. No hyphen. But I didn't like that because it's a clumsy word. So I invented another expression, which I know of an essay called this, called the after-death of the Holocaust. We read a lot about, we hear a lot about the afterlife of the Holocaust, how people survive. There's another story to tell. And you'll see examples of it from what I'm going to show you, about how people survived and died at the same time. And you know, every time I read the Boston Globe in the morning and see how 100 more people have been blown up, children, women, poisoned with gas, I say to myself, I'm alive, but we live in a world that is saturated with death at the same time. Called not the afterdeath of the Holocaust, it's the afterdeath of the kind of world we live in. And that's what some of these survivors are trying to articulate. So my point is, the more I watch these survivor testimonies, the more I realize that there's a field here that is not superior to, but just as important as the work of historians of the Holocaust. And it took a long time to convince people of this. A Holocaust testimony is a wound of memory. Was the first substantial book to study Holocaust testimonies as they were presented by Holocaust survivors. And I'm going to show you just a few examples. The first one, and they're all brief excerpts. There are six, I think, excerpts. And after I talk about them, we finish, and I hope we can have some discussion of. First woman is a woman who arrives in Auschwitz. She's just been there for a few days, a few weeks, I'm sorry. But she's hungry. And she does something that, at first glance, you and I may think is a terrible thing to do. But once you begin to think about it, it seems less terrible. The last thing I'll mention that I learned by watching these testimonies is that although, as Elie Wiesel used to say repeatedly, if you weren't there, you will never know. And I used to object to that and say, why am I wasting my time studying the Holocaust? But I'm going to know. Until I realized it was perfectly correct. If you weren't in Auschwitz, you will never know what it was like to have been in Auschwitz. Even if your parent or parents were there, you will never know what it was like. And to justify my career, I said, well, I've got a chance on that. And so I said, by listening to all these testimonies although I will never know, thank God, I say, to know what it was like to have been there, by listening to these testimonies, I begin to imagine what it may have been like for the people who were there, and not only there, but in other camps elsewhere. And that's the value not only of Holocaust literature, that's the value of Holocaust testimonies. And I'm still watching them, and some of them are 5 or 6 hours long. I never begin watching one that I don't watch to the end, because you never know when something very important will come up, maybe in the last few minutes. Right, so, you want to put the first one on? Can't take back the applause.
Close my ears.
close my ears.
For the swearing that she did.
The swearing that she did.
And still in all together, we went to work in the morning.
Still in all, we went to work in the morning.
And the whole day she didn't forget that she lost.
The whole day she didn't forget that she lost a piece of bread. And never admitted that I took it.
I was very sick, I was very sore, and I was very sore because I was hungry and she was hungry.
Very hurt, I was very sore and very sorry.
But somehow, once we were outside, there was some.
Somehow we were outside, it was a beach digging.
Something always.
Picked up something.
To put in your mouth, but there was no solution, you got diarrhea and you were.
And then you got diarrhea.
Dying anyway.
Then you were dying anyway.
I was actually always diarrhea, that was the end.
That was the end.
This wasn't good and that wasn't good, so what choice did we have?
So this wasn't good, she said at the end, so that wasn't good. So what choice did we have? At that moment I felt, you know, I'm felling, I swelled with pride because this is 1980 and I invented choice with choice in 1978 and she certainly had never heard of that. She simply confirmed it because what choice with choice means is so this wasn't good and that wasn't good, so what choice did we have? Choice with choice is not the difference between right and wrong or bad and good, which most of us are privileged to choose. It's the choice between bad and worse. And what we need to understand when we listen to Holocaust testimony or read some of the memoirs, think about it, is that when you lose the sense of agency, it's not because of a failure in yourself. There is no mention, I think, in any of the excerpts I'm showing you, of the people who are really guilty. They're called the Germans. She steals the bread because she's starving. And she's starving because the Germans are not feeding her. They wanted to starve to death. And she feels guilty because she stole that piece of bread. The whole concept of guilt, I realize, has to be revised when we talk about concentration camps. Although there are survivors, and I'm going to show you an example in a minute, of survivors who say they feel guilty. And I have had an argument with the next excerpt I'm going to show you, Abe, who feels guilty for what happened. And I say, Abe, what you're feeling is remorse because you were not in a position to do it. No, I feel guilty. It's my fault. And one of the most painful things for me to hear was the survivors blaming themselves because they still inhabit a moral universe in which they believe a human being, and that's what they were, should be able to do something to help someone they love. And the malice, part of the malice of the Germans was deprive human beings of the ability to be able, human beings not overtake and repeat because of their cowardice or their weakness or anything like that, but because they remove the ability to be an agent in your own life, you're then thrust into the world of choice with choice where the only desire is to remain alive. Can we blame human beings for wanting to remain alive? Who doesn't want to? Sometimes the price you pay is stealing the piece of bread from the woman in the book. An amusing sideline. 8 years later, we set up a program down at Yale to re-interview a number of survivors who had given very good interviews originally to see if their stories changed, to help confirm the idea some historians have that testimonies are not reliable. So we wrote 25 people asking if they'd agree 8 years later to be re-interviewed. We thought maybe four or five would agree. All 25. And I did all 25 interviews. And what we discovered was that there was barely a change in the testimony. Why should we be surprised by it? If you told your story right the first time, why shouldn't you tell your story right the second time? The one thing she did was to apologize to me. I said, Hannah, what are you apologizing? She says, I accused that woman of swearing like a truck driver. That insulted her and the truck driver. but that's what she said. So So the story didn't change. Right. Now, the next one, many years ago, I was in Washington State to give a lecture, and they had a dinner of survivors, and I was there. I was sitting next to this man, and he was a survivor. He was in hiding with his family. And he told me the story. He was in hiding with his mother and his younger brother and a young girl named Clara, who was an orphan. The Germans had already killed her parents, and so she was living with them. And his father, who arranged for them to hide in the loft of a Christian farm, Polish farmer's barn, arranged a separate hiding place for them. I said, what happened? He said, we were lucky. When the Russians regained control of the area, we were still in hiding. And they all survived. And I said to myself, you know, on the plane going home, one happy story I can report. Finally. At the dinner, I met his daughter. And I said, what do you do? She said, I do documentary films. She said, I made a film about the survivors in this community. Would you like to see it? I said, send me a copy. So she sent me a copy. And, no, I'm sorry. I'm jumping too ahead. Can we do this first? Okay. And she sent me a copy, and in it was what you're going to see now. He hadn't told me about that. Changed the whole picture. He begins, you could hardly hear his voice, but his voice lists very quickly. He said, we had to whisper because if the Germans heard us, couldn't speak in a loud voice. Can you hear any of that?
Yes.
Yes.
Take your microphone and put it to wherever the sound's coming in.
Go
over there.
Yeah,
maybe
it's loud
as you can.
That's the first thing you need to kill. Because I already told this story.
And what's the facial expressions of all of these
people? As a citizen have to be made.
You said his mother was pregnant when they went to come.
You couldn't have, you know, you couldn't speak loud, but you couldn't have anybody crying. How do you know a baby is not going to cry? How can you tell a baby not to cry? So the decision was made. You have to kill the baby. When the baby was born,
choice between killing the baby or keeping the baby alive. You can't feed the baby will cry, the Germans will hear us, and they'll take us all and shoot us. So one life or all life. No meaningful decision. Now, one of the perplexing consequences of this scenario is that a killing has taken place. And no one is ever punished for it. And there's no way of redeeming that money. When I first heard that, I said to myself, trying to imagine, I don't know what to imagine. When the Russians come and liberate them, and the husband comes to find them, and knows his wife was close to term and must have given birth to the baby, and says to his wife, where is the baby? What does she tell him? What does he say after she tells him? What do they do about it? You can't arrest any German with this crime, because no court would find that German guilty. They're nowhere near the scene of the crime. Crime is not the word either. When we talk about the poverty of vocabulary in discussing the Holocaust, there's a clear example. Mother's not guilty of murder. But she killed the baby to save other lives. What about justice? This case, there's no possibility of justice. In fact, after the war, there was no possibility of justice. Hundreds of Germans, many more than I thought, were hanged after the war. Does that balance the murder of 6 million Jews? To say nothing of the 3.5 million Soviet prisoners of war who were allowed to starve to death in open pens in somewhere in Belarus or Ukraine, where the Germans stopped feeding them. They were reduced to cannibalism, and then they all died. Justice itself loses its meaning when we talk about that. Yeah, we have to keep talking about it. Where's my agent? Sit down. All right, we need you. A man who arrives at Auschwitz with his mother, his father, his older brother, he must be 18, his brother, and his, what he calls his kid brother, who's about 7 or 8. Okay, they don't know where they are. The Germans have said, raus, raus, alle Juden, raus, get out of the boxcar. And he gets out of the boxcar, and he's recalling what happened at that moment.
This man came to storm an SS man, and he wanted him for the thing. He put my brothers together and my little kid brother. And I told my little brother, I said, well, sorry, gay, to Tati and mommy.
Go to Danny and mommy.
Over the way. And like a little kid, he followed. He did. Little did I know that I sent them to the crematorium. I killed my brother, who lives now in New York, used to live in South America. Every time we see each other, and he says, no, I am responsible because I said that same thing to you. And it's been bothering me too. I've been thinking whether he has reached my mother and father. When he did reach my mother and father, he probably told him, he says, Avrubia Gesund, that is a skein, so gainless with ink.
Abe says I should go with you.
I wonder what my mother and father were thinking. Especially when they were all, when they all went into the crematorium. I can't get it out of my head. It hurts me, it bothers me, and I don't know what to do.
Notice, as I mentioned earlier, a clear example of blaming himself for something that he's not guilty for. Actually, you know, I finally concluded, in a sense, as a sign of decency in him, in finding someone to blame for this. Restoring a moral universe, said my family. My brother, little brother was killed, and someone must be at fault. And, of course, it's the Germans who killed the rest of the family. But if he hadn't said that, the brother might still be alive. And one of the things we learned from that excerpt is what I call the limits, not only of not being able to know certain things, but the limits of not knowing, of not being able to imagine certain things. Part of the Holocaust universe is a vast black hole which we'll never see into and never understand. He says, I wonder what my parents were thinking when they went into the crematorium. He's left to wonder that for the rest of his life. And so are we. There are some questions that just don't have answers. And it's hard to believe that we inhabit a universe where some questions just don't have answers. And when I told him, Abe, you're not guilty of this, the German, no, he says, I'm guilty. And that's part of what I call the afterdeath of the Holocaust. He's alive, but he's still living with the fate of his brother, who could have avoided that fate if he kept his mouth shut. What does he do with that? He doesn't know what to do with it. He says, I don't know what to do. And there's no one who's ever going to tell him what to do. All right? Now, wait just a minute. This is a married couple. In the beginning, we did some joint interviews with husband and wife. In most cases, it didn't work out. The husband would say something, I would say, it wasn't like that. And the husband would say, what are you talking? That didn't happen. So we decided, let's let them tell their own stories. But watch the interplay between them. The husband and wife, they've got two grown kids, been married a long time. They inhabit two different universes while they tell their story. They're unshareable stories, even between husband and wife, as you hear.
Afterwards?
What's that?
They met after liberation?
They met after liberation because they were not married before. She was. But not to him.
And my brother was always crazy. For some strange reason, he came to this
says, just after he said to the wife, here, I don't need the tissue, the brother says, take my jacket, I don't need it. brother says, the one thing I'm afraid of, he says, I don't want to be shot. He says, they came to the barracks, they took my brother out, and they shot him. Okay, and we're left to make the connections. Then his wife killed him, Custer, which had nothing to do with his story. Please let me know if you can't hear me. Did no one hear any of that?
I have a baby boy.
I had a baby boy, did you hear that?
Yeah.
And I did have food for the baby. So I took care of my bed. And I sent the other mother for the show. The baby. And I didn't have enough food for the baby, so I took care.
She would have been 18 or 19 at the time she was 12.
And while I was taking a meal, I was giving lunch to my kids. And I went to the doctor, and she said that I had trust in my kids because I didn't have the proper food. And I started to have pain, so we had to operate. So I had to go there by myself. And I went to the operator to get my injections. They took us to the buses, they brought us to the airport. And we finally were a train to a cattle train.
Can't hear.
Nearby was a cattle train.
As I looked there.
As I looked back.
I think for a while I was in a daze.
I think for a while I was in a daze. I didn't know what was happening.
I saw them taking the men separate.
I saw them take the men separate, the children separate, the women separate.
So I had the baby, the coat that I had, the bundle. And I wrapped around the baby.
Took the coat around the baby.
And I left that.
And the coat made a bundle.
Because I saw the Germans, they said left and right.
And I went through with the baby.
But the baby was short of breath.
Started to choke.
So the German called me back. What do you have there?
Said, what do you have there?
I didn't know what to do because everything was so fast.
Everything happened so suddenly.
To look back, the experience was, I think I was numb or something happened to me.
To look back, I think I was numb or something happened to me.
I wasn't there.
I wasn't there.
And he stretched out his arms, like he turned him over to the bundle.
He stretched out his
and
arms. I should turn him over to the bundle and I gave him the bundle.
This was the last time I had the bundle.
But
if I look back, I don't think that I had anybody with me.
I look back, I don't think I had anything with me.
To be myself.
But by myself alone. Even when I met Jack.
I didn't tell Jack my face. Jack just found out the secret.
Jack just found out recently. What's going on inside Jack's head at this point?
I died and
She was so happy to see me. She says, where's the baby?
I said, what baby?
Right there, I said, what baby?
I said to the doctor,
I didn't have a baby. I don't know of any baby. That's what it did to me. First, when the German says, give me a baby, she says, no, I didn't know what to do. everything happened so suddenly. I wasn't prepared. And when people say, why didn't the Jews do something to resist? You say, what should she do? Should she say, help, help, he's taking my baby? Should she run away and say, you can't have my baby, at which point they both get shot immediately? She has no recourse. That's what this choice is. She says, I wasn't prepared for this. How do you prepare in advance for that moment in your life when an SS man will say to you, give me your baby, and you don't know what to do? Do you think about how you prepare? You can't prepare for it. Because this, has, this is an eventuality which no one ever thinks of. When people say, why did they just walk into the gas chambers? Who knew it was a gas chamber? Whoever imagined that this is what the Germans have cultivated, the so-called culture people, and do to us. Then she said, after she gives up the baby, since that time, all my life I've been alone. The camera pans on her husband, who's just heard his wife of 20, 30 years say, since that time, all my life I've been alone. How does he process that? He stares through his glasses. Maybe he doesn't process it. I'm not sure. Well, and then she says, I don't know. I think I died, I was dead. There's another example of what I call the after-death of the Holocaust. And in fact, at the end of the testimony, which goes on for more than an hour, the two of them are talking about their children. The daughter married a doctor, the father was a lawyer. What more could Jewish parents want? So there's this other side of their life. They are not. There's another point I discovered in watching these testimonies. Psychologists say not only that survivors are permanently traumatized by their experience and are dysfunctional, there are a number of psychologists who say interviewers have been permanently traumatized by doing the interviews. Do I look traumatized? And I may have the flu, but that's not trauma, that's just an illness. They're wrong. They have led both a normal life, what I call a chronological life, and what I call a durational life, in which they recall certain moments which endure in their memory as if they're just happening now. They don't change, they don't evolve into something better. And they said they lead what some survivors call compartmentalized lives. One woman said, I take my children to ballet, I take them to soccer, we go to dinner with friends. And then there's the other, she says, and it's dark, and it's painful, and it's scary. And she's being interviewed by a psychoanalyst, whom I happen to know, who says to Mrs. Weiss, you're one of the most optimistic people I know. And she says, no, what are you saying? How do you say that? And he says, Mrs. Weiss, have you ever thought of having sessions? And it takes her a few minutes to process what he's saying to her. You should see an analyst. She gets up and walks out. And the person who did the interview and said that was a friend of mine, denies he ever said that. And I said, I just looked at the tape last night. Absolutely, he said, he doesn't, I can understand he doesn't want to remember that. I just have two brief excerpts from the same woman. For me, she is the most dramatic testifier I have ever encountered. In the first very brief segment, she says, how shall I explain to you what Auschwitz really was? And she tries to develop her own vocabulary and her own imagery to convey to us, knowing in advance you will never know what Auschwitz really was. But I've got to help you try to imagine it. And this brief excerpt, then one more, and then I'll be finished, and then we can talk. Can you hear that?
No.
Auschwitz, if I were to describe it,
yes.
I would say,
there has not been.
There has not been.
It has not been.
expression when Auschwitz really was.
It's a hard question.
Hell on earth.
The silence of Auschwitz was hell.
The silence of Auschwitz was hell.
The nights were hell.
Nights were hell.
And the days, somehow.
Somehow.
The bell was 3 o'clock in the morning.
The bell was 3 o'clock in the morning.
It was 4 o'clock, 7 o'clock, and then the sun came out.
Four
it was not like the sun.
The sun came
up. Swiftly,
it was not
it
like
was
the sun.
Bright.
It was not like the sun.
It was always black to me.
It was not bright.
That moment was life to me. It was destruction.
Not life to me.
It
was destruction.
And when the moon was out,
when the moon was out,
destruction.
Destruction.
They almost forgot what life was all about.
They almost forgot what life was all about. In that attempt to find a life, she turns everything, she converts everything. The moon was dark, the sun was black, the light was dark, life was death. And she really, I think, does in a few minutes a remarkable job in changing the way in which we think about what she's trying to describe. Now, in the next one, and this is the last one, she's thinking, and very few people bring this up, but she brings it up in the first part, of, what shall I think about the Germans? She says, I can't hate, because I'm not a hating person. But there are times when I wish they could know what I know. I hope you can hear this. So, she has a line in there which is the most remarkable line I ever heard in
a
testimony.
I've been liberated 35 years.
I've been liberated for 35 years.
And as I get older, and I children are no longer all self-sufficient, no longer at home, and I'm not busy being a mother and a wife.
Not busy being a mother and a wife.
I feel in the middle of so how I should conduct myself with the Germans. How I should feel. Should I hate them?
Should I
despise them?
Should I despise them?
Should I go out with a banner and say, do something against them?
Should I go out
don't
with a banner and do something?
I never found the answer. And I have to go according to my own consciousness. I cannot conduct myself like my husband does, like my children, or how the world has said. Then the only thing I can say is that.
The only thing I can say is that.
If I feel like ignoring them, I don't hate them.
I don't hate them. I can't.
I feel
hate
I would waste a lot of time in my life.
I feel I would waste a lot of time in my life.
But sometimes I wish.
Sometimes I wish.
In my darkest hours. And they would feel.
They would feel.
What we feel sometimes when we are uprooted.
What we feel sometimes.
Children,
when we're uprooted.
I'm talking like a mother and a wife.
I'm talking like a mother and a wife.
When there is nobody to share.
When there's nobody to share.
Your sorrow.
Your sorrow.
And your great happiness. Do you have to call up and say something
to call your happiness. There's no one to call up.
I have given birth to a beautiful
to say I've given birth to a beautiful baby.
Well, most of them, when holidays come, I have tried to preserve the holidays as I saw them at home. Thanks to my own children.
Trying to preserve the holidays as I saw them at home.
As I saw them at home. But the spirit is not there.
The spirit is
it's
not there.
Beautiful. My friends tell me that
it's beautiful. My friends tell me it's
beautiful. It's very spiritual. But
I
know it's not the same.
I know it's not the same.
There's something missing.
Something missing.
I want to share somebody who knows me really.
I want to share it with somebody who knows me really.
My children, how old are they?
My children are now.
And there's nobody but mom and dad.
Nobody but mom and dad.
Thank you, sweet. Even a grave to go and cry to.
Not even a grave to go and cry to.
And I sometimes.
And sometimes.
Wish. They would feel that.
They would feel that.
It's not easy to do this way.
Not easy to live this way. That's the epitaph for the testimony. The line that always goes to your way is that you describe the Seder, which is beautiful, and her children are there, and her husband is there. They all tell her how beautiful it is. She says, it's not the same. I want to share it with someone who knows me. Really? She's got her daughters and her husband right there. And we know what she's talking about. We're dead. Not even a grave to go in the car. So that also received half the death of the Holocaust. And on that solemn note, let me end now so we can have a little conversation. Jeffrey Hartman, who was an international renowned scholar in literature, but who was on the Kinder transport from Frankfurt to England, and so he survived in England. But his wife was in Bergen-Belsen. And he became the advisor to the archive, and he spent a lot of time. He died just last year fundraising for the archive and in house there. And there are dozens and dozens testimony like these in which the survivors are reflexive and thoughtful, and you can see from what you said there was hardly an interruption. When Hannah has trouble finding the word bunk because she doesn't know it, the interviewer says bunk. She says, that's what she called him when my roommate. No. And she says, you mean bunk? She says, yes, the woman in the bunk. But otherwise, no one asked them anything here. They handled it on the And then the Revson Foundation gave Yale a grant of $500,000 to expand their work and recruit more than just the two interviewers. I turned out to be one. And to interview many more people. And the one policy, and it was a good policy, was never to interview anyone who interviewed before, because they didn't see any point in carrying the same stories twice. One of the many, forgive me for saying this, many weaknesses of the Shoah Foundation archives, who have interviewed people the third, the fourth, the fifth time, and I watched a lot of them, and including ones of people whom I interviewed for Yale, and there's no advantage of having that second interview at all. First story was told.
Good question. What kind of interview techniques were used to get to that type of testimony?
Sorry.
What kind of interviewing techniques were used to get to that type of testimony?
Trust. You know, we sat on a little FEMA stage. The cameraman, in the early days, very primitive cameras with lights blinding you in your eyes. And I would say, let's begin. You tell us your name, where you were born, when you were born. Talk a little bit about your childhood, and then proceed. I interviewed one man who was involved in the uprising at the Sobibor death camp. And he said to me, my story began at Sobibor. I don't want to talk about anything else. I said, be my guest. I did not say, we'll get to that later. And so you have different rhythms in the testimony controlled by the survivor. The first technique is to allow the survivor to control the rhythm of his or her testimony, because they know what they're doing. Second, this isn't the technique. You have to know something about the Holocaust. I mean, if he says, I was in the uprising in Sobibor, and they killed one of the SS men before the breakout, and the interviewer says to him, what was Sobibor? You'll get such a look of contempt on his face, and he might even clam up. But we had people who knew something about the Holocaust. And I'll tell you, minutes. The Shoah Foundation brought me out to California many years ago to talk to their people when they were still interviewing people in the 90s. And I showed some of these. Steven Spielberg's favorite personal theater, although he wasn't there. And after I finished, I said, are there any questions? And the first question was from a staff member out there who said, why don't we have any testimonies like that in our blew me away, because I had never watched any of their testimonies. I didn't know the answer then. Now I know the answer, and the answer is because you prepared for it wrong, and you didn't train your interviewers, and you had interviewers who didn't know anything about the Holocaust. Nothing can be more offensive to a survivor than an interviewer who doesn't know what they're talking about. So we would have periodic meetings, the interviewers, to look at some earlier testimony to see what we could refine, what we could do better. But other than that, we just said, if you have a private agenda, suppress it. Don't bring it into the interview, but this is not about you, it's about them. And once they realize that, they'll tell their story. Once they realize that you're controlling the interview with your questions, you get a different kind.
May I ask how we can watch these? Are they on YouTube, or is there some way that we can access this and watch these?
They have all now been digitized and are available to any university that requests them free of charge. Okay?
But not personally?
Personally, no. Has to be through a university. Now, you can go on their website. You can go on their website. They have excerpts that are available to anyone.
We use those in our class. Link on our course website to the Fortune Archives. But we haven't seen the full interviews. And we hope that we might be able to see them.
Eventually, they wanted to give it to any qualifying institution who asked for them.
We'll ask.
I was wondering if you had interviewed any German survivors, and did any of them try to use your expression that they were also victims of choiceless choices?
By German survivors, you mean civilians or members of the SS, the Army?
Anybody.
Yes, I interviewed a professor from UMass Amherst who grew up in Germany during the war. She finished the war and that he left and came to America because he said his uncle was a major in the SS. And he was a very decent person and he was openly critical. He was a young boy during the war, so he was involved in something. But it was clear that his family was a Nazi sympathizer. And he said he was so disgusted by everything that happened there, he left the country and came here. War criminals don't get into this. Why should they? If you want to see some interviews with war criminals, watch Claude Lanzmann's film Shoah. Mm-hmm. He secretly, with a hidden camera, interviewed someone, and caught him, and almost beat him to death. A very risky thing he was doing. He lied to them and said, there's no cameras, I just want to talk to you. He had a truck parked outside, he had a camera hidden in his bag, and he was videotaping the entire hear some of them talking, but they don't know that they're being videotaped. But otherwise, no, there are very few interviews. We were interested in interviewing survivors, and Germans are not survivors of the Holocaust. Many of them are survivors of other things, but not of the Holocaust.
This may be, or it's definitely an oversimplification, but most people who study or who teach about the Holocaust have the goal that we should learn from this so that it should never happen again. However, you know, with Syria, something on a smaller scale, it's happening again. And with all of our studying and studying and studying, we have no idea what to do. I mean, maybe you. Do you have an opinion as to what is the moral thing to do?
My opinion is not to use the Holocaust to prevent future catastrophes, because that's not the reason for studying the Holocaust. The reason for studying the Holocaust is to learn something about the Holocaust because it happened. It happened to people, and if we don't study it, it might as well not have happened. Their stories sink into oblivion, and to me, that is shameful.
So you don't claim never again?
Pure baloney. I mean, they should leave a letter on it. It should be ever again. Because that's the truth we have to live with in history in Rwanda and Bangladesh.
Right.
So not as comprehensive as the Holocaust, but genocide in their own right.
Yeah.
It's part of human nature somewhere in the world. Not everyone, but the people in power. That's why we have to be very careful about who we elect into power. And we're not very careful about that, as some of you will understand. Yes.
This is a bit of a follow-up on the last since ethnic cleansing in the modern sense originated in the United States with the eugenics of the end of the 19th and the beginning of the 20th century, and since the eugenics movement is still alive and well in the United States, since we have not reverse the Buck versus Bell decision of the Supreme Court, and with all this background, what are your thoughts about it happening here?
You mean the Holocaust happening here?
Yes.
I think it's impossible. The reason Hitler was able to do it was that he wasn't elected, he was appointed chancellor by President von Hindenburg. People had no choice. The last free election in Germany, the Nazi Party only had 44% of the vote. He never had a majority. Unfortunately, shortly after Hitler came to power, someone blew up the Reichstag building. Some people say Goering was responsible. Other people say a mentally retarded Dutchman named Van der Lubbe did it. But as a result of it, Hitler had President von Hindenburg issue emergency decrees, temporarily suspending the Reichstag. And the first thing Hitler did was to have arrested enemies of the people, sent them to Dachau or wherever. The number of camps were open by 1933. I can't imagine that happening here, because we have 50 states. We don't have an SS. We don't have stormtroopers. We have a lot of rowdies and gangsters, but, and we have not yet, no centralized power capable of calling all the shots. We have a judiciary that can prevent the program of not letting anyone into the country. So I can't imagine it happening here. In addition, for all its failings, Donald Trump is not a killer. And I've never heard any indication that his ambition is to murder his enemies. Whereas one of the first things Hitler did a year after he took power was to kill the leadership of the stormtroopers because he thought they were getting too strong. So nearly murdered them. I can't imagine that. I'm not being naive. I mean, lots of bad things can happen, but not a genocide. We have our own genocide in the past against Native Americans back in the 18th and 19th century. And we have our own shame of slavery, but that was not genocidal. The slaves had economic value, whereas Jews did not for the Germans. So they wanted to see them all dead. Whereas slaveholders did not want to see their slaves dead. They wanted to see them procreate. But, I mean, we're talking about the Holocaust, and I don't want to get too much into it. It's an important question, and my answer is, I do not see it.
Okay, I think we'll leave it here. If you have additional questions, you can come up and speak to Professor Langer. Thank you again.